promise of Jesus' second coming a promise or a threat? And a four-year-old playing with his trucks on the back of the church shouted, "A promise." And a little child shall lead them. So today we look at hope. How is it that the Grinches of Christmas want to steal our hope out of our hearts? Heart shrunk two sizes over the last couple of years. There is hope in Jesus Christ.
Cherubim and seraphim fall. Verse 4. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, all thy work shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Open your hymnals to number 243, Emmanuel. We will sing it twice through. And stand and join us.
God with us in all things, at all times, and in all places. Let us pray. God, this is the season to prepare our hearts to love you, to serve you, to know our neighbors, to reach across divides and make peace. And we get preoccupied with running to Walmart, Kohl's, and JCPenney's and all points in between. Call us back home. Home to our heart center, to the love of Christ Jesus that is to be revealed to the world by his people. Call us back home to places of mercy and justice for all people, that we would be aware of the injustices around us, even though it doesn't affect us. Open our eyes that we might see those who are in need of food or clothing or a warm place to sleep. Grow our hearts to twice their size. Break our heart with what breaks yours, Lord God, because it is our heart's desire to follow Jesus, our Savior, our Messiah, and our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, David and Stephen are going to play for us. If you have an offering that you would like to give, we have offering baskets here at the front. You may bring those up at this time, or you may put it in after worship. Please enjoy this time of worship with David and Stephen.
As little children, we would dream of Christmas morn, and all the gifts and toys we knew we'd find. But we never realized a baby born in blessed night gave us the greatest gift of our lives. Reason that he gave his life. We were the reason that he suffered and died. To a world that was lost, he gave all he could give to show us the reason to live. As the years went by, we learned more about gifts, giving of ourselves and what that means. On a dark and cloudy day, a man hung crying in the rain because of love, because of love. That he gave his life. We were the reason that he suffered and died. To a world that was lost, he gave all he could give to show us the reason to live. I finally found a reason for. It's in giving every part of my heart to him. And all that I do, every word that I say, I'll be giving my all just for him. Please remain standing and turn your celebration hymnals to number 250, and we will sing verses 1, 3, and 4.
Our scripture this morning is taken from Jeremiah 33, 14 through 16, and selected verses from Luke. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up from David, and he shall those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. And now from Luke 21, 25 through 36. There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all the things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighted down with dissipation and drunkenness, and the worries of this life, that day catch you unexpectedly like a trap, for it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole. alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all of these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. And fulfilled that promise of redemption. Now we live in the so-called in-between times. The kingdom of God is here and now. We can experience it, glimpses of it, hope of it, see it, just pieces here and there. But it's not complete yet. And so we wait. All creation groans for the completeness, the fullness of Christ returning. The kingdom of God that has come, but isn't completed yet. So we continue to prepare for Christ's ultimate arrival. Luke tells us to be on guard, not to let the worries and the cares of the world to weigh us down. It's a trap. Do you feel like a mouse? It's a trap. This little apocalypse in Luke, remember, apocalyptic literature is supposed to bring hope, not fear. It shouldn't strike fear in our hearts. It should give us hope because we are waiting, longing, yearning for full redemption of what the kingdom of God looks like. To be back in that garden in right standing with God and each other. The beauty of the kingdom where all have justice, all have mercy. The lion lays down with the lamb. The scripture paints this beautiful image. Our hearts should burn within us every time we get a peek. We got a peek on Thursday when 280 meals left this place in the name of Jesus to feed others. That's a glimpse of God's kingdom on earth. Did you see it? Did it bring you hope? Well, what steals your hope? What can catch us off guard sometimes? It's what we believe. You see, we're often under the misunderstanding that if we grieve or we have despair or disappointment, that's what steals our hope. That doesn't steal our hope. Absolutely not. You see, the scriptures are full. Go to the Psalms. The scriptures are full of people who lament, who rail at God, who scream at God, who say things like, take my enemy's baby's heads and bash it against the rock. That is ultimate grief and despair and disappointment in life. And yet in those moments of railing and disappointment, they are still connected to God. When we scream and we shout and we rail and we're disappointed, we're still engaged with life. We still believe that God answers prayer. We still believe that God catches our tears in a bottle, that God knows every hair on our head, even as it falls out. No, what steals our hope is not genuine emotion of grief, of loss, of disappointment and despair. No, what steals our hope is apathy. What steals our hope is apathy. As long as we're railing to God, praying to God, screaming at God, talking to God, we are still in relationship with God, and we still believe that there is hope. It's when we get silent that it gets dangerous. It's when we get silent that Grinch is laying a trap in the background of our minds to say, throw in the towel, give up, nobody cares, why should you care anymore? It's to give up and say, I don't care anymore. I can't care anymore. That's when we lose hope. Apathy is that place when we no longer believe that our prayers are heard or that our cries will be comforted. It's that place of indifference. It's a place of boredom. It's a place of laziness and lethargy that says there is no God. There is no God. There is no Emmanuel, God with us. There is no reason for hope. There's no reason to pray. There is nothing. There's no reason to continue to prepare for Jesus. It's been 2,000 years. He is not coming back. That's what that Grinch will tell you. When you are at your lowest, or even when you are at your highest moment in life. When John was given the revelation of the persecution of the early church, the beast of the Roman Empire, and what would transpire, he says to the church at Laodicea, I know your works. You are neither hot nor cold. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I will spew you out of my mouth. Apathy makes God want to vomit. So what causes apathy? ThriveWorks blog writer writes, simply defined, apathy is a lack of feeling. It's a lack of passion, a lack of emotion, a lack of excitement, a lack of concern. What causes it? Negative thoughts and feelings about ourselves. If you've been feeling incompetent, useless, worthless, or otherwise pessimistic about your abilities, you may soon be moving into apathy. A major life event that affects you greatly. Sometimes major events like being fired from a job can leave you feeling so upset that this distress manifests itself as apathy. For example, imagine that you've been working for your employer for 5 years and you're comfortable, you're expecting a promotion, and instead you go in on Monday morning and you're fired. Once you've moved past that feeling of anger or being upset or asking, why me, you become indifferent. That's apathy. Maybe you're stagnant. Your life is a boring routine. You get up, you go to work, you go to bed. You get up, you go to work, you go to bed. You get up, you go to work, and you go to bed ad nauseum. And all of a sudden, we've settled, and we expect less of ourselves and less of our lives, and we come to expect nothing. You know, the motto for those that are apathetic is, if you don't expect anything, you won't be disappointed. Maybe you're overwhelmed or worn down. You know, that routine, that 9-to-5, can not only be boring, it can be exhausting. Where there is nothing left to give, and you're worn down, and you're left with this feeling of detachment. A lack of energy to do anything. It's when you say, I cannot fight this fight anymore, God. I am tired. I am done. I am weary of well-doing. I cannot keep going. And you give in to that. And you let it win. And it becomes apathy. Now, there are mental illnesses and physical illnesses that can cause depression. That's different than apathy. Depression can be treated. If you experience down days for more than a couple of weeks, you know, more than 10 days or so, or it's a pattern, go get attention. If you had a lump on the side of your neck growing, you'd go to an oncologist, I hope. There is no shame in seeking medical attention for medical disabilities and mental illness. If you are depressed, there is hope and there is help through medication. No, apathy is when we get ourselves so involved in the world that the cares of the world overwhelm us. You see, apathy is a cancer. And it can take root in something as benign as our recreational life. I can get bored scrolling on Facebook and become apathetic about all your woes that you put on Facebook until the point is that I don't care. And it starts with just what I'm doing for fun. I cannot care about going to yoga class anymore and become apathetic about taking care of my body. And then you know what this cancer does? It spreads. It spreads, and suddenly I don't care about my family anymore, or I don't care about my job anymore. And then I get to where I don't certainly care about my spiritual life, because if God loved me, he wouldn't let me feel this way. And so I get to the point that I don't care about anything. And it infects not only people, but organizations. And when an organization is affected by apathy, when people do not care anymore, when we get to the point that we don't even care enough to fight, it dies. You see, I am of the mind that I love the United Methodist Church. And I know that we all do not agree on doctrine, on theology, on politics, on a lot of things that are going on in our world. We do not agree. But you know what? We're still engaged with each other. So if someday we separate, better to separate in peace and in love and to find our own way to love each other, even in the difference, than to become apathetic and not care. Because once you are apathetic and do not care, you have lost everything. You have lost your compass. You have lost your morals. You have lost your soul. When you do not care about anyone or anything. And oh, it is tempting. It is tempting for those who see it every day as those who see it once a week or once a quarter. It is tempting to throw in the towel and say, I don't want to fight this fight anymore. I am tired of it. I give up. But if we give up, we walk away from hope. And it becomes spiritual death. Now, I could have thrown in the towel this morning. I thought about throwing in the towel this morning, because every time we want to do something, those little gremlins run around the church and they mess with stuff. You would be surprised what happens on here on Sunday morning before you come in and sit down. So I will not be deterred. Jeff Allen is now a Christian comedian. Jeff Allen was an atheist. He was an atheist who liked to play golf to the point that he would even play golf with a Christian. Plus, the Christian had money and got him onto the good golf courses. His Christian friend asked him about Jesus. Don't believe that stuff? And he said, have you ever read the Bible? No. Well, then you're not just not a believer and an atheist. You're a moron. Because an atheist at least has read the Bible and made a conscious decision not to believe. You're just not even bothering to read. You're lazy. So this was the story of Jeff's life, though. You see, it was a spiritual apathy that he had. But as he got towards his 40s, he realized he was apathetic about his marriage, his career, his job, his children. His entire life did not matter. He was going to get a divorce. They got 2 minutes from the courthouse, and his wife, for whatever reason, said, I can't do this. So they go back home, try it another year, and he's just all the more apathetic. She packs the children and their things to go home to her dad in Ohio, and she said, you either find a purpose and meaning in life, or we are not coming back. That's where we will pick up with Jeff's testimony, we hope. Go to the red one, this one, and it's on. Yellow one's gone. I will not be deterred. Okay.
Maybe I am nuts. I don't know. But I'm trying to get into this. And I rip one open, I throw them on the floor, and I go there. Yeah, there's a couple tapes. All right. starts talking about it. And basically, Solomon's conclusions were that life without God will have no meaning. And I didn't understand that. And he began to explain about the creation. In order to enjoy the creation, you have to know the one that created it. And if happiness were an act of will, we'd all be happy. Because that's basically what we want out of life. Everybody wants to be happy. You ask them. So if it was an act of human will, why aren't we happy? We're the most medicated species on the planet. We really are. And all it is, what I found out, what he said, was something has to come outside of us, inside of us. Change our hearts, and then work its way out through the act of service to others. And I was blown away. For the first time in my life, I heard something that made sense. And I believe it was because that day, God chose to turn it on inside me. That was the light switch. Bam, it went on. And I was like, wow, this is it. This is what I was looking for. I wanted purpose. I wanted some reason to get up in the morning and put one foot in front of the other. And then I said, without God, I have no. Well, how do I get God? So I opened another tape, put another tape, another tape, another tape, because I'm a compulsive, addictive personality. I was just, I mean, I'm not kidding you, man. And I'm making notes in my Bible, and I'm going like, man, this is the greatest stuff I've ever heard. At one point, I wanted to run on my lawn and hold the Bible up. Have you read this thing? Wow, what a book. Man, this is amazing. I don't know why it was 40 years or whatever. I mean, this was a 13-year journey up to this point. I'm not telling you. This did not come overnight. I didn't get the road to Damascus epiphany that Paul got. I'm telling you, man, I sought this. And I went out and I laid in fetal position. I used to go to the desert and scream up at God, all right, if you're up there, show me, you know. And I mean, it was today, that day, bam. And I'm listening to these tapes. And then he gets the Jesus that he knew, the one he says, he says he was at a prison. I'll never forget this line. I love this line. He was at a prison doing a sermon, and he said to the prisoners in this prison, he said, I would not walk across this stage to tell you about my religion, Christianity, but I will crawl on my hands and knees through broken glass to hell and back to tell you about the love of my Savior, Jesus Christ. And I heard that as a man. As a man, I said, that's what I want. I want something. I want something that I want to die for. I believe this, that a man is not, and I'm talking about a man, I'm not a woman, but I'm a man, and I said, a man is not fully alive till he has something in his life that he's willing to give his life up for. And I'd like to think I'd give my life up for my wife and kids, but I'll tell you something, I'll give my life up now for my Savior and my right to profess this faith, because I'm telling you, it transformed my life.
Just for men. It's for all of us. Without a purpose to live, it is easy to become apathetic. We have to catch the cancer and eradicate it before it gets a foothold in our life. We have to call it for what it is. It's the Grinch. It's the devil. It is evil. It is whatever name you want to give it. But when we allow it to get a foothold in our life and we are at the point that we say, I quit, I give up, I'm not making any difference, I'm not making any headway, life is never going to get better. When we get to that point is when we have to stop it, because it will take over all of us, all the way down to our very soul. Just as that pastor said on that tape, I will not walk across this stage. I won't walk to the house to tell you about my religion, about Christianity. But I will get on my knees and go through broken glass to tell you about my Jesus. Any moment, any day. Because Jesus is what makes the difference in our heart. You can have the religion in your head all day long, and it will not transform your life. It will not give you hope when you want to quit. It is your relationship with Jesus. It is having him in your heart and not letting go. That is the only way I know to get through this life and to have hope. It's the only way to receive that gift of hope that Jesus came to bring us. And if you want a purpose in your life, Let me come and talk to me about this book. Don't take grandma's word for it. There are grandmas and grandpas out there that all they could see was the doom and gloom. All they could see was, ain't no reason to take care of this earth. God's going to destroy it. You know what? That is not in this book. It's not in there. Neither is take care of your own folks first and let everybody else go to the wayside. There is so much that we believe that's not in this book, and yet the beauty of what is there, of a God that comes to earth as Emmanuel to reestablish the perfect garden, the perfect kingdom with us, for those of us who have purpose and want to participate in it, for those of us who want to see those moments on Thanksgiving, on the face of a person that is alone on Thanksgiving Day, and you get to give them turkey and dressing and your best smile. That's the stuff that gives hope. George Bernard Shaw said, "The worst sin towards our fellow creatures is not to hate them, but to be indifferent to them." That's the essence of inhumanity. How do we prevent apathy? What's the cure? In Romans 12, 9, Paul writes, "Let love be genuine." Let love be genuine. "Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another, showing honor. Do not be slothful in your zeal," i.e. apathetic. "Be fervent in spirit," i.e. not apathetic. "Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saint and seek to show hospitality." Apathy says, "I don't care. I don't. You can't hurt me if I don't feel." You see, sympathy might be one notch above that, that I can sort of feel sorry for people at certain points in their life. A step above that is to be empathetic, to have empathy, so you can walk a mile in their shoes, so to say, that you can actually feel what it feels like to be a mother that's lost a daughter and planning for the funeral that we're doing this afternoon. You can have empathy and feel that. But there is the mark of Jesus Christ, which is compassion. To suffer with. To not only feel it, but to walk alongside those who suffer. The best way to get over apathy is not to think less about yourself, but to think about yourself less. Five quick ways. Repent, because repentance means to turn and go a different way. Remember. Remember that love you first felt when you accepted Christ. Renew. Get away from it all. Go behind a locked door and scream it out, pray it out, just don't let go of it. Redirect your thoughts. Think about somebody else. And restore. Restore your relationship with Jesus Christ. Kindle that flame in your heart. We'll see what the Grinches look like later. Jack Thone wrote, "Apathy is evil. Apathy and evil. The two work hand in hand. They are the same, really. Apathy doesn't care as long as it's not personally inconvenienced." What are you expecting? Have you taken on that model, "Well, if I don't expect anything, I'm not going to be hurt. If I don't expect anything from people, they can't hurt me. If I don't expect anything, I can protect myself. I won't be disappointed." What are you expecting? If you've grown weary in well-doing because you feel like it's not making a difference. The greatest threat to Christianity is not division. The greatest threat to Christianity is apathy. During our time of reflection, I would ask that you give yourself a heart check. Are there places in your heart where apathy is trying to get in or is taking a hold?
263, what can I give him? And we'll sing it once through. Please stand. Turn to 244, come thou long expected Jesus. Let us find our rest in thee.
Talk about the religion of my youth that's required to give up certain things when you accepted Jesus. As a matter of fact, we all laughed because we thought you had to pretty much give up everything. Everything from makeup and cutting your hair to wearing pants. All those kinds of things that I now know is legalism. Because what I give up now to have Jesus in my heart is apathy. I get to give up apathy, and he gives me hope. May you go in the peace and the knowledge and the hope of our risen Savior that loves you more than anything. In his name we go and serve. Amen.